Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most gracious. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I greet you with the greeting of peace. And it's my honor to call upon Elder Sue Crow Wiggle, who is a two-spirited Blackfoot from the Bikin First Nation. She is a champion powwow dancer, singer, and a drummer. I invite you tonight to start us off in a good way.
Ani bojo oki. That's hello in my language, Blackfoot. I just have to do a little correction. I don't consider myself an elder at this point in my life yet. So I've got a lot of learning to do. I was invited to come and open the ceremony for everyone here and to acknowledge the land that we're on. And we do acknowledge the land of the Wendat, Mississaugas of the Ucredit, the Haudenosaunee. And we just like to honor, you know, say our honors to the people who have gone on. In our culture, we don't really mourn for those that have gone on. We celebrate their lives because they've gone on to the Creator and they're walking with our Creator. And they're also in a better place than here on earth. And that's part of the reasons why we sing in honor of them. So what I'm going to do for you is I'm going to sing an honor song that was sung by Red Bull out in Saskatchewan. They were a champion drum group out there. And they sang this song for all our ancestors who have gone on. And so with that, sing that song. Please rise.
Good way. My name is Reverend Alexa Gilmore. I am the minister at Windermere United Church and a member of Faith in the City here in Toronto. On behalf of your city, I thank you for finding your way through grief and sorrow, anger and confusion to be here, offering solidarity with friends and strangers who will leave knowing that they are not alone. As we lock eyes with those who stand near us, we discover a reflection of common hope for a future united by love for all of God's diversity. We have come on our own and in small groups, trusting that in this act of solidarity, the freedom from fear is found. United, we become a wave of love that carries us from a time of grieving into the embodiment of our peaceful future. Tonight, where hatred has left wounds upon our Muslim family members, we bring our interfaith threads of love. We know that vigils are not enough. We have already held 3 citywide vigils this year. In the days to come, there must be hard conversations about race and privilege and white supremacy. But we tonight come to mourn. To mourn and to know that in the prayers of this community, in the stillness of bodies breathing together, healing is found. So as we begin tonight's journey, I invite you to breathe in and out together. We are one body, united. Let us pray. Here we stand, God of justice, hearts cracked open by white supremacy and hatred. Here we stand, Spirit of love, held in the solace of one another's arms. Here we stand, Creator of diversity, loving the uniqueness of every gathered member. Here we stand, divine goodness, steadfast in our belief that tonight is a defiant act of united hope that flies in the face of evil. When words fail to capture our pain, when people fail to notice our suffering, when hatred threatens to overwhelm our senses, be with us, divine love. Enter into this time and space through our words, prayers, song, and silence, and transform us into the people of peace that you know we can be. In the name of all that is sacred, we pray. Amen. Tonight, many of us are struggling to calm our hearts, to dry our tears, to find the words to express our pain and our sadness. Our communities from across Toronto, across this province of Ontario, across Canada, and across the world are shaken, but not broken. Today, on this day of Jum'ah, millions have gathered across this nation and across the world. In spaces like this, in mosques and other places of worship, to remember and hold space for the 49 innocent lives that unjustly were taken from us. Tonight, we're standing together in defiance, declaring that we will not be tied down by fear, that we will not be intimidated, that we will not hide, but we will continue to stand together, to organize, to love and care for one another. Yes, we will be accepting prayers, thoughts, love and condolences. However, without tangible commitments to act on these sources of hate and bigotry, anti-racism and Islamophobia, then this becomes virtual signaling. And now I start with dua supplication If you choose to, you can say Ameen as I take breaths. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. To God we belong and to Him we return. Indeed, our eyes shed tears, our hearts are full of sorrow, but only we say what pleases Allah. O beloved ones, we are saddened by your departure, we mourn your losses. May you always be remembered. May you be placed in Jannah, in the highest ranks of Firdaus. May your souls rest in power. May your memories flood us with love and hope. May your loved ones heal. May we have the courage to collectively act against all forms of hate and Islamophobia. May we be people of justice. May we stand against all forms of oppression. May the weak voices of racism, xenophobia, Islamophobia, and all forms of bigotry that are working tirelessly to divide us, may they be drowned out by the voices of justice. Our all voices that gather tonight and everywhere else, may we be free of fear. May we be free of hate. May we be free of ignorance and arrogance. May we be always humbled. May we always choose love, hope, and light. Ameen ya Rabb. Ameen ya Rabb al-Alameen. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika Allahumma nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. It's my honor to introduce our first speaker for tonight, the Honorable Ahmed Hussein, Minister of Immigration and Refugee Citizenship. Please help me welcome him.
Brothers and sisters, before I begin, I'd like us to take a very brief moment of silence to remember those who we lost in Ethiopian Airlines crash that crashed this past Sunday, including 18 Canadians. Thank you. I've been processing what happened yesterday and today in New Zealand, and I got a phone call from Prime Minister Justin Trudeau as well as Mayor John Tory, and I've been speaking to leaders of the community, and it's been very difficult to process what happened. As many of you know, members of the Muslim community, Friday is a special day, it's a sacred day. It's a day for members of the community to go to mosques and to find a moment of tranquility and peace and reflection in that house of worship, just like in other houses of worship, like synagogues, temples, churches, and many others. And to think that a mosque, a place of peace, tranquility, reflection, meditation, and peace, becomes a place where people are targeted simply because of their faith is horrifying. And we can't let that happen in Canada and anywhere around the world. And as we reflect on what happened, we have to ask ourselves, how did this come about? How did we get to the point where we are, as the previous speaker said, we are at these vigils frequently? Make no mistake, 49 innocent people were killed in those two mosques in New Zealand, and countless others were injured in a terrorist attack inspired by Islamophobia against innocent Muslims. We should never be afraid to name the victims and to name the religion and to name the places of worship that people are targeted in. But this was not the first. A few months ago, we all remember the ugly face of anti-Semitism when it reared its ugly head in Pittsburgh and targeted 11 members of the Jewish community in the Tree of Life synagogue. And prior to that, 9 members of the African American community lost their lives in a racist terrorist attack against a church in Charlestown, North Carolina. Before that, six members of the Sikh faith were targeted in a gurdwara in Wisconsin by someone who committed a terrorist act against those innocent victims. And we all remember the six Muslim deaths in the mosque in Quebec City and countless injured in Quebec City in the beginning of 2017, inspired by anti-Muslim hatred. So when we combine all these and many other incidents that I won't mention now, but when we examine all of this, we see that there's a clear pattern of intimidation against people of faith, people of color, of the other. And so we have to do our best to make sure that we fight that hatred, we fight that intolerance. We move beyond these vigils and thoughts and prayers, although they're very important, but to also call this hatred out. Call it out in our communities, in our societies, in our families, in our friendships, in our workplaces. We can never ever normalize this hatred. We can't. We can never normalize hate. We can never normalize hate speech. We can never try to repackage it as white nationalism or something else. Let's call it for what it is. And know that your government stands with you. Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, I am here with my colleague Adam Vaughan, other elected representatives, to say that we will stand shoulder to shoulder with Canadians and everyone else as we condemn this, but also as we tackle this head on. And this discourse, the discourse of marginalizing the other, the discourse of peddling in fear and division, has to end. We have to come together and double down on inclusion. We have to come together and shore up each other and stand up for each other. I'm so proud of members of the Jewish community and other faith groups that have reached out to Muslim Canadians today and previously. It means so much. It means that as Canadians, we don't kick each other down. We stand for each other and we include each other, we strengthen each other, and we pick each other up. So I'll leave you with this. As we see a gathering storm of anti-immigrant, anti-refugee rhetoric, and anti-Muslim, anti-Jewish, racist rhetoric and attacks against faith communities everywhere, we have to be not only vigilant, but we have to double down in Canada, and we have to say no to hatred, we have to say no to Islamophobia, we have to say no to anti-Semitism, we have to say no to anti-Sikh bigotry, we have to say no to homophobia, and we have to stand with each other in these difficult moments and beyond. And we have to work every single day to eradicate this hatred in our midst, because, and we have to tell those who peddle in this kind of hatred, whether they be ordinary citizens or whether they be politicians, that this is the logical extension of that hatred. And we have to tackle it head on and say, not in our name and not in our presence. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.
For your words and reminder that we as Canadians must stand together, protect one another, and say, not in our name. Our next guest this evening and speaker is the Honourable Rod Phillips, NPP and Ontario Minister for the Environment. Please join me in welcoming him.
It is truly heartbreaking to be here this evening on behalf of Premier Ford and all of the other members of the Ontario Legislature from across all of the parties, many of whom are here with us tonight, to mourn and to stand together in this time of grief. This morning, this country awoke to the news of this senseless tragedy, and it profoundly shakes our sense of collective consciousness. We are all appalled by this deadly terrorist attack on defenseless worshippers, an attack that violently has taken the lives of 49 innocent individuals. The people of Ontario grieve with the families of those in the Elnor and the Linwood mosques, and we stand together, firmly, in solidarity. Earlier today, I gathered with the Muslim community in my town of Ajax at our Masjid Al-Quba Mosque, and together we offered prayers of peace. Together, as we do tonight, we condemn the hatred and the act of violence towards our Muslim brothers and sisters. Yet words cannot undo these unimaginable acts or prevent another tragedy from unfolding. This tragedy did not occur in isolation. As a community, we need to continue to come together and recognize the strength of our diversity, but continue to work to defeat Islamophobia and all other forms of bigotry. Where we see hatred and bigotry, we must confront it. We must call it what it is and work together to eliminate its influence in our society. When fear and ignorance creep in, we need to look to our hope in humanity and our faith in one another. If we ignore hatred and bigotry, as we know, we are silently condoning the root cause of this kind of horrible, tragic devastation. It's our responsibility to remain steadfast in our love for one another and remain strong in the face of adversity. Together, we find strength in the resilience of our shared hopes and our dreams. And as has been said tonight already, vigils are important, very important, for our community to collectively mourn together. But it is only by collectively working together that we'll avoid the next vigil. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Rod Phillips. We are really looking forward that all our levels of government and across party lines will work together to address this pressing issue. It's my honor to welcome our next guest, Rima Burns McGowan, my friend and close ally. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. Member of Parliament, Beaches East York. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I want to begin by acknowledging and thanking my fellow MPPs, NDP MPPs for being here with me tonight. Suze Morrison, Tom Rakosevic, and Faisal Hassan, and Gurtan Singh. Jill Andrew was here earlier. As somebody who identifies as both Jewish and Muslim, I feel as though I've been here way too many times in the recent past. And like many of you, I'm standing here still in shock, heartbroken, heavy-hearted. This afternoon I went to pray Juma at Baitul Iman Mosque in my riding of Beaches East York. And the heaviness, the almost disbelief that I could feel in that room. How did we get to this place? It is bad enough that we lost 49 innocent lives, but I think that what particularly got to me as somebody who lost extended family in the Holocaust is how do we get to a place where somebody is gleefully live streaming this heinous act? In what universe in 2019 is that okay? And I think that what this does, perhaps, is it becomes a defining moment. It is no longer possible to ignore the link between this kind of violence and divisive, hateful political rhetoric. And it is absolutely critical that it stop now. We have to speak and act intentionally. This Tuesday, I will be introducing, and this has been planned for a long time, It was announced actually on January 29th, which was the second anniversary of the Quebec mosque shooting. I will be introducing a private member's bill at Queen's Park to designate January 29th of each year as a day of remembrance and action on Islamophobia. And I think it's absolutely critical that we all come together across party lines to pass this bill, to make sure that it gets through committee, to enact it, and then to go on to ensure that similar bills are enacted in other jurisdictions across the country. It's important to use the right words. This was Islamophobia, an act of hatred against Muslims simply for being Muslim. It's not enough to mouth words and prayers after violence. Action is critical. It is important that we understand that we have to have absolutely zero tolerance for hate in public forums. There can be no platforms for Islamophobes and anti-Semites and racists. Don't follow them on social media. Don't hire them. And if you find that they're working for you, make sure that you fire them. This is not about partisanship, but it is about power. And with power comes responsibility. So use it and rid us of this scourge. To my fellow brothers and sisters in Islam, and to my fellow citizens who came here on this rainy night and who are watching across the city, across the province, and across the country, continue to hold your elected officials in power accountable. This is basic. This is fundamental. We need to build the Ontario and the Canada that we want to live in. And it needs to be a country of love, not of hate. Thank you. Thank you, Rima, for those words and that call to action, that reminder that each one of us as citizens has a responsibility to call out hatred where we find it and to call those in power to responsible leadership. I would like to invite Deputy Mayor Denzel Minnan-Wong and Kristen Wong-Tam, City Councillor, to speak to us tonight.
Good evening. I'm here on behalf of Mayor John Tory and Toronto City Council to express our deep sadness following the terror attack on the Muslim community in Christchurch, New Zealand. We join you in mourning the innocent people who were murdered as they gathered for Friday prayers inside their mosque. We join you as well in condemning the horrifying evil that would perpetuate such an attack on people in a place of worship. I know many here in our Muslim community will feel shaken by the senseless attack, and it raises fears of further hate-fueled violence. We are here today to stand with our Muslim community and to make it clear that you have our unwavering support. I want to thank Toronto Police as well for the work they did today, reaching out to the Muslim community and visiting mosques and other places of worship to ensure everyone's safety. But that's what we do here in Toronto. We support and care about each other. I want each and every member of our city's Muslim community to know that your city supports you. Your city is dedicated to protecting you, and your city respects and embraces you. Just as Toronto embraces people of all faiths and backgrounds. We will not let this sickening act of violence change our steadfast commitment to diversity and freedom. What I hope we will all do in the wake of this attack is redouble our efforts to stamp out the toxic hatred that feeds this type of violence. Hate was at the root of this attack, the Quebec City mosque attack, the Pittsburgh synagogue attack, and the Charleston church shooting. So we commit again tonight to shattering that hatred. We commit to standing up for the Muslim community, for all our communities, and speaking out against Islamophobia, anti-Semitism, racism, and all other forms of hatred and any violence that gives rise to it. Thank you all for coming here tonight. I hope this vigil helps bring some comfort to those who need it on this very dark day.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak. This is no doubt a very difficult, difficult time for our friends and family in the Muslim community. And I know that there are probably not enough words that can be said to ease the pain and the anguish that languish in hearts and minds today. Strangers reaching out to one another across the globe, trying to make sense of what has happened. And of course, once again, we are here grappling with the same questions of why. Let us know and understand that this was not an act of one individual. Whenever there is a mass shooting and its specific targeting of any particular individual or group, it rarely is an act of one individual. This was a deliberate and coordinated attack of the Muslim community in Christchurch, very similar to what we saw in Quebec City. Regardless whether it's one individual that is arrested and charged, or three or four, no one wakes up one day and decides that they will go on a mass shooting rampage. There are a series of events that would have led to this, conversations that would have led to this. People that they follow, these individuals that are influenced by them, and how they echo each other in the chambers of the dark internet, where it is unchecked, where free speech is allowed to somehow propagate hate, where we have followers on social media that say that it's okay, it's just free speech, and that somehow all of this is legitimized because all those words have impact. And as that impact starts to escalate, it gets louder and louder. And then, should we be surprised when these incidents take place? I think for those of us who have been on the front lines of fighting hatred and violence and bigotry and white supremacy and Islamophobia and all the other forms of hatred, know that this does not happen in isolation, and that elected officials of all parties have a responsibility to make sure that they take to account the members of their party. That is not an open tent when you give them refuge, or you speak in dog whistle politics that allows them to fester and promote hatred. When they speak out against immigrants and refugees and asylum seekers and blame them for social challenges of the city, the province, the state, or their country, you are part of the problem. It is simply not enough for us to light candles or say a prayer. We all have a responsibility to do better and to do more. Clearly, lives are depending on it. And not just that, the social cohesion of our planet, country, city is depending on it. I am very encouraged to know that the province, through Rima's bill, will consider her private member's bill on the National Day of Remembrance and Action on Islamophobia. And I know that City Council, through the leadership of my colleagues Nathan Shan and Joe Mahevic, had moved a very similar motion, asking both the federal and provincial government to do exactly the same, to take a moment, one day, out of an entire year, to reflect on what has become an epidemic, not just here and not just in New Zealand, but around the world, which is the rise of Islamophobia and the hatred towards Muslims. And I will be very interested in seeing the debate that ensues as that private member's bill makes its way through. I'll be very interested to know who will be supporting Rima's bill and who will then be rising against it to speak up against the Muslim community, saying that they should not be singled out, that Islamophobia is not real, that somehow behind all that is the boogeyman of the Sharia law. I think that we need to make sure that we watch that debate very, very carefully, because we will be taking receipts and we will remember who stands with the community and who does not. And when it comes down to the vote, I hope that all of you will take notice that there will be those who will have wanted to speak at vigils like this and across the city, across the country, and then there'll be the same people who will then rise in the House, in the Ontario Legislature, who will speak up against it. And the same politicians will speak up against immigrants and refugees and asylum seekers, and that is not the way forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Minister, and thank you, Councillor Kristen, for debunking the lone wolf myth and for reminding us. Yes, we will. Yes, we will keep those receipts. Yes, we will be watching. Our next speaker is Mahmoud Qasim from Islamic Relief.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. Before I begin, I would like to offer condolences, heartfelt condolences to the families that are grieving and the families that are dealing with this tragedy, not only in New Zealand, but also condolences to every single person that is here today. And for every single person that is watching, stand, because this is for fear being placed in our hearts to not attend the mosques. Yes, we grieve. Yes, we feel the pain. But today being Jum'ah was the day where the masajid were completely full. The prayers were completely full. People from the different faith backgrounds came out to support and hold hands with the Muslim community to say that we will not let you go through this alone. We will not let you face this alone. So we say to this, we say no to hate. We say hate is the factor that's resulting in all this. Hate is the factor that caused the shooting in Quebec. Hate is the factor that is dividing us. Hate is the factor that is creating all this divide in our community and across the world. So we need to stand united. We need to stand united in condemning this hate and fear. We need to stand united against the right-wing hate and their hate speech and the echoing that is across different communities. We need to stand united in the hate and the fear of Islamophobia and the fear for Muslims and their religion and inciting terror in the hearts of people to hate the Muslims as well as non-Muslims alike. We need to stand united to protect our neighbors. We need to stand united in the rights of worship of everyone, of every faith, and every background. In Islam, we have a Quranic principle that states, push back against the aggression with compassion, so that perhaps the one who has shown aggression, so that the pushback would turn into them being a dear friend. This is the opportunity, my brothers and sisters. This is not the time for us to stay back and for us to become silent and for us to have that fear. This is the time where we reach forward. This is the time with our compassion as Muslims that we believe we have to have our hands out to our entire community to know who we are and what Islam actually stands for. So I ask every single one of you, brothers and sisters of the Muslim faith and of all faiths, to stand united against this hate and to say to everybody out there that we will not let this divide us. With that, I conclude. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mahmoud, for the reminder, the prophetic reminder to push back against the aggression with compassion, to turn the stranger who hates into our neighbor, our friend. I would like to invite back to the stage Sue Crow Eagle, Indigenous singer, drummer from the Blackfoot Nation.
The speeches and the compassion and the strength that I hear coming from everyone, it's enlightening for myself. You know, because there is a lot of hate out there. There's a lot of dissension and whatnot, even among the Aboriginal people, you know. And I, for one, have to keep pushing myself to do this type of work, no matter how much hate is out there. But as I stand here, I was thinking about the songs that I'd like to sing. And there's one song I composed, it's called Proud of Our Nation. You know, and we all come from different backgrounds, you know, and yet we're all standing here united. You know, we should all be proud of who we are, you know, and strive for that unity. And the other song that I thought about was a song that was composed by Maggie Paul. She's an elder from Nova Scotia, the Mi'kmaq community. So I'm going to kind of combine the two, and if you don't mind listening, okay, well, have a good jam session.
For warming our heart with that beautiful singing. Thank you all for staying with us, for keeping warm. We know the weather is cold, it's raining, but the love and the hope that's gathering us today is keeping us warm, so thank you. Our next guest is Father Jack Castello, priest, Jewish priest, and currently faculty member of Regis College, University of Toronto. Please help me welcome Father Jack.
Thank you very much. I agree with
everything that has been going on here so far in saying no to hatred. And I have come with just another side of the message, which is yes to goodness. It's not to deny the darkness of the world that we all believe in the goodness of the world. I come here, yes, I'm a Jesuit priest, I come here as a Christian voice, I come here also as a member of Romero House for Refugees, where for 27 years actually, we have received refugees from all over the world, the majority of whom have been Muslim. We are all talking about our friends. We are all talking about sympathy for people we don't know in New Zealand because they are in some way our friends. They are our brothers and sisters. And so the main message I have comes from a Muslim theologian. I know I'm a Christian. I'm not betraying anything. My message is from a Muslim theologian. Tariq Ramadan. Tariq Ramadan is a Muslim who came to the West and has devoted himself, he's very much alive, has devoted himself to speaking to his fellow Muslims about how can we, with integrity, with verve, with energy, with joy, be in good communication with non-Muslims. Can we do it easily? Can we do it joyfully? Can we do it freely? And he says, return to our roots and this is what you will find. And so Tariq Ramadan offers a humanist interpretation of Islam, reflecting on the Quranic teaching of God, creator of the universe and speaker to human beings. Ramadan arrives at a theological interpretation of human and cosmic existence. He calls this the universal message of Islam. God creates human beings by his breath. This divine breath remains with them, orients them, enables them to distinguish between good and evil, makes them recognize their need for God. God's light shines on all women and men. The fitra that orients human beings towards God is in fact stamped upon the entire created order. The one God, Tawhid, draws the entire universe into reconciliation and unity. I'm going to drop most of the rest of what I was going to say. I'm going to say to you and to me, we must resist hatred. We must resist fear. Those of us who work with refugees know that no matter what we do and how we work, we have to keep working on those Canadians who do not want to be afraid of refugees, who do not want to be afraid of attackers and potential dangers to our society. We want to overcome the fear, and in overcoming the fear, build community. It is the goodness that takes the guts out of the fear and out of the hate. Become a community of goodness is what Tariq Ramadan is calling for. And I would only say this, Pope Francis, when he went to his most recent meeting with many very significant Muslims, spoke with them, listened to them, and came with this statement towards the end. You and we believe in the same God. Let us live it. That's what I ask for. Let us live it.
Thank you, Father Jack. Friends, tonight we are living it. Let us remember to live it tomorrow, next week, next year, our whole lives, united, one family. I'd like to introduce our final speaker for this evening, Nadia Hassan, Deputy Director of the National Council for the Canadian Muslims. Can you please join with me in welcoming her?
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Good evening. Thank you to the organizers for organizing the vigil today, and thank you all for being here, for coming together as a community, and for holding space for each other as we process the unspeakable tragedy in New Zealand and stand in solidarity with the victims and survivors of the attack. You know, just when you think you have no more tears, something like this happens. My name is Nadia Hassan, and I work for the National Council of Canadian Muslims. We're a Muslim human rights and civil liberties organization here in Canada. At the NCCM, our everyday work is dealing with the entire spectrum of Islamophobia, from everyday individual experiences of discrimination and harassment to legislation that unfairly stigmatizes Muslims to vicious and unrelenting attacks on our community. What happened in New Zealand may be shocking to some, but as devastating as it is, it's not shocking to us. It's shattered our hearts, it's gut-wrenching, it's surreal, but it's not shocking to us because of what we see and hear every day on the job. It was a really tough day today for my team as we tried to grapple with what's happened. Islamophobia is a dangerous and lethal form of hate. White supremacy is a dangerous and lethal form of hate. And if we don't call out hate at every opportunity we get, it will fester and grow into something much worse than just words. As we've seen at the New Zealand Mosque today, as we saw at the Pittsburgh Synagogue last year, at the Quebec City Mosque the year before, the Charleston Church in 2015, at the Oak Creek Gurdwara in 2012. Our Muslim sisters and brothers who went to pray Jummah, their local mosque in Christchurch today, likely woke up this morning going about their weekly Friday routines, just like you and me. They probably scrambled to have breakfast before setting off for work, worried about their children's lunches, coordinated rides to the mosque for Friday prayers. They didn't think that this would be the last day they would get a hug from their kids, or that this would be the last time they spoke to their friends, or the last sajda that they would make when they went to pray at their mosque. They were just regular people going about their everyday lives. And that's exactly what the killer didn't see. He didn't see them as human beings with every right to live. And that's the kind of thinking we need to stop. That's the kind of hate that we need to stop. And enough is enough. Today, the NCCM stands beside the victims and survivors of the New Zealand mosque massacre, and with all those who are working tirelessly around the world to tackle Islamophobia and hate in their communities. We see you, we feel you, and we're praying for you and your loved ones. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you, Nadia. We are going to be concluding our evening with a prayer, a surah, a chapter from the Quran, Surah Al-Fatiha, which means the opening. I am going to be reading it in Arabic, as those 49 people have read it in their last prayers. So we are going to be reading it not for only our own peace, but for theirs as well. We are going to be praying the prayer that thousands of people who were prevented from going to mosques across New Zealand did not have a chance to pray in gathering.
So I invite you to, if you do know the surah, if you do know the verses, to read it out loud with me in Arabic. And if you don't, I invite you to pray in silence or out loud in whatever language, in whatever way that you speak to the Creator or to the universe, in whatever way that you bring peace to yourself and those around you. So I am going to be starting in Arabic, and I invite everybody in the audience, if you choose to stand up, you can. If you choose to read with me, please do read with me out loud. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين سبحانك اللهم بحمدك اللهم استغفرك ونتوب إليك جزاكم الله خير may Allah سبحانه وتعالى reward you may you all be blessed may we all be in peace prosperity and may we all be surrounded with love and light now and always Ameen.